I'm very excited because let me just say this to you. I pray today that the Lord visits you in the way that he has been visiting me in preparation of this message. Because the title of this message is simply The Glory of God. And my prayer for you today is that you will not just hear about the glory of God, but that you will experience the glory of God. So we're going to start in the book of Exodus, and we're going to spend a little bit of time talking about someone who knew a whole lot about the glory of God, and that was Moses. So let's start with Exodus chapter 33, and I have the verses up in King James. Please feel free to follow along in whatever version that you have. But I wanted to bring my Bible that I've had for a few years. It's all marked up, and you know, that I'm comfortable with. I love it. So yeah, I could have had my iPad and all that good stuff. But today I'm doing this old school. Is that all right? Exodus 33, 7 through 11. And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without or outside the camp, afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. And it came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out to the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without or outside the camp. And it came to pass when Moses went out unto the tabernacle that all the people rose up and stood every man at his tent door and looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose up and worshiped every man in his tent door. And the Lord spoke unto Moses face to face, as a man speaks unto his friend. And he, Moses, turned or returned again into the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. This is a rich and meaty passage. We're going to unpack it a little bit because it sets the stage for where we're going today. Hallelujah. God had always put in Moses such a visionary heart and attitude and mindset. Moses was someone that God worked on and worked over in so many phases of his life, from the time that he was rescued as a baby, could have been killed, raised in the house of Pharaoh in royalty, but in the secular world, trained as a prince, you know, the prince of Egypt, and all of these things. But then when he tried to take matters into his own hands, knowing that he was called to be a deliverer, he made a massive mistake and he killed someone. He was out of God's order and literally had to run for his life, went from being royalty and ended up on the backside of the desert with a bunch of smelly sheep. Not a pretty sight. I can imagine that as year after year after year went by in Moses' life, that any dreams, any hopes that he had of God bringing him into the place of his destiny might have begun to fade a little bit. Might have begun to seem like they were never going to happen and never going to come to pass. But one day, he saw a sight that he couldn't ignore. He saw a bush that was burning, but the bush wasn't being destroyed or consumed. And he turned aside and said, "What is this?" And God says, "Take off your shoes. This is holy ground." And as we know, Moses had a tremendous visitation from God, a visitation that altered and changed his life forever. And at that point, God called him and said, "Now that you are humbled, now that I've worked out your character flaws and issues, now that you don't think you're such a big deal, now that you're not willing to take matters into your own hands, now I can call you to be my leader. I could call you to be my deliverer." By that time, he was so worked over and humbled, he goes, "Forget me, God, I can't even talk. I stutter." God's kind of rolling his eyes. You know, God's Jewish. Oy vey, you know? And it says, "All right, already, I'll give you your brother Aaron, you know? Can't do my best Jewish accent, sorry. But so God gives him Aaron, who's apparently quite eloquent later on, but God brings Moses into this place where, reluctant leader or not, he comes and God uses him powerfully. Brings the 10 plagues, takes them out of Egypt. They go through this most supernatural occurrence in all of the Old Testament, where they're facing the Red Sea with Pharaoh's army at their back, and God does a double miracle, helps them cross over the Red Sea on dry land, and then drowns Pharaoh's army in the same Red Sea. Powerful. So now they're out in the wilderness, taking the long route to the Promised Land, because a whole lot of complaining, rebellious folk, because none of us are ever like that, right? Needed to get some things straight. And so Moses, again, the visionary, says, we're going to pitch this tent, this tabernacle. What did he call it? The tabernacle of the congregation. Someone's paying attention today. I like that. The tabernacle of the congregation. I want you to see something really profound in this passage. He sets it up according to what God tells him, and he calls it the tabernacle of the congregation because God's heart and vision through Moses is that all of the congregation will not only worship the Lord, but access the presence and the glory of God. But watch the curious thing that happens. Moses goes into the tabernacle. Remember, he was not the high priest. His brother Aaron was, okay? He goes in, but does anyone follow him other than Joshua? No. They stand, everyone, at their tent door and watched him go in. What does that mean? It means they stood in the place of familiarity. They stood in the place of their comfort zone. I'm willing to go this far, but I'm not going to cross this line. I think I'll watch from a distance here. That's really cool, Pastor, what you're doing. Really like what you're doing, Pastor. You go, Pastor. Wow, I love the way Jonathan Foley leads worship. I love the way Elizabeth Jones leads worship. You go, Jonathan. You go, Elizabeth. That's really great. Oh, man, when Lisa dances, is that just like awesome? And Michelle, my gosh, the way Jeremiah plays the drums. You go. But I'm not crossing the line. Hope you're getting a little uncomfortable in this room, because that's my intention. Oh, now you're really going to love it. And then it gets better. The glory of God begins to manifest. There's a cloudy pillar that descends. Pretty cool. Watch out, Hollywood, you know? And there's this physical manifestation of the glory of God. And again, God is basically beckoning his people, saying, if you didn't get it by watching Moses, I'm going to show up and show you my glory. And what do the people do? They rose up and worshiped, maybe took a little step further, but where did they stay? At their tent door. But what does it say happened to Moses? He and God spoke together, face to face. Bible says God spoke to him as a man speaks to his friend. And the one man that was willing to go with Moses, Joshua, his heir apparent, was so in awe of the glory of God that when Moses went back out, Joshua stayed. I want to submit something to you. This church doesn't need any lessons on praise and worship, as was evidenced this weekend, as was evidenced in the service this morning. But I want to say to you that God has promised that righteousness and praise will spring forth before all the nations. And the challenge that God has been speaking to us all weekend is that we can't just keep this for ourselves. We can't just be the Bless Me Club and the Us Four No More Amen. And it's really great in this church, but that's it. We've got to be willing to pay the price, number one, to cross the line and say, I'm willing to go further into the presence of the Lord, knowing that I'm going into the Holy of Holies and I might get smacked if my heart and my attitude aren't right. But God, I'm willing to press through. I'm willing to cross that line. I'm even willing, God, if you want to deal with my sin, if you want to deal with my bad attitudes, if you want to deal with my bad habits, if you want to deal with my addiction, I'm willing to cross the line. I'm willing to step over and say, God, whatever it takes, I'm not going to be satisfied until you speak to me as a man would speak to his friend. I believe the Holy Spirit is really wanting to do something and take you all even a little deeper and get you so provoked and hungry for more of God, for more of the presence of God, that you're not satisfied with where you're at. What is the goal? Who stayed in the tabernacle? Joshua. What did Joshua represent? The next generation. The next generation. God wants to touch the next generation. He wants to continue to minister. He wants to continue to touch hearts and lives, but not just who we see and who's around us and what's familiar. He wants us to go way past the walls of our comfort zone. That's why I love that we went outside and worshiped. I sensed in my spirit, by the way, and I never said this, that as we were worshiping, I felt that the vibrations of the sound and the worship were going down the hill. I sense, and I hope you hear testimonies, that people were actually being healed on this mountain, that people were actually having chains break off of them on this mountain, that people were actually being touched and drawn to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ on this mountain. Hallelujah. So then we go further, and we go to verses 14 through 23, if you want to put that up in this same chapter. Moses says, basically, I need you, Lord. I need grace in your sight. And God answers Moses in verse 14, and he said, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. And Moses said to God, if your presence doesn't go with me, carry us not up. We're not even moving. If your presence doesn't go with us, we're not moving. I love that. For wherein shall it be known here that I and your people have found grace in your sight? Is it not the fact that you go with us? So shall we be separated, I and your people, from all the people upon the face of the earth. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name. And he said, I beseech or beg you, show me your glory. And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, but you can't see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there's a place by me, and you shall stand upon a rock, and it shall come to pass, while my glory passes by, that I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand while I pass by, and I will take away my hand, and you'll see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. I really can't read this passage without being deeply moved. Because God loved Moses' heart. Moses says, you don't understand. Never mind my training in Egypt. Never mind my training on the backside of the desert. I understand, God, if your presence doesn't go with me, I have no business taking one step forward. God, show me your God says, I will. You want to see my face? You can't do that right now because you're not going to make it through this. But I'll let you have a glimpse of me that no one's had before. it's interesting even that God allowed him to see the back of him, because I think there was a message there. Moses would always follow the Lord. Amen? But God is saying to us, how badly do you want the glory of the Lord? Some of you are saying, well, I don't know what it is, though. We're getting ready to talk about that. How badly do you want the glory of the Lord? Are you willing to continue to press through? I won't get into it, so we won't actually put the, well, you can just put up the reference. Exodus 34, 28 through 35 is the entire description, thank you for the reference up there, of where Moses goes up and gets the tablets of stone and the law, and because of 40 days and 40 nights in the presence of the Lord, he comes down so shining with the glory of God that they cannot stand to look upon his face. They're literally terrified. Now, don't get nervous on me. I'm not saying that you should just be terrifying to people. Some of you were really hoping that. No, what I'm saying is this. I believe that like Moses, we can come to a place where we come into the presence of God in such a dynamic and a powerful way and so intimate with him that when we come out, people are convicted of their sin. People look on us and kind of almost want to do this, not because we've ever opened our mouth, but because the glory of God shines so brightly through us. They're like, okay, there's sin in my life. What does the Bible say? Sin separates us from God. But I also believe that that same glory will draw people who are hungry and say, help me get the sin out of my life, man, because whatever that is that you got, I want that. I want that. I shared this weekend that I had done a large fashion event. I had to multitask and do a lot of things and help coordinate, help the models with their clothing change and so on. And this one, shall we say, challenging model came up to me after it was over, and she, you know, doesn't know the Lord, and she says, wow, like you have the coolest aura. I didn't rebuke her. I understood. She was getting a glimpse of the glory of God. So we had a great little conversation. See, we draw people in, don't push them away. Amen? See, the world may not know what to call it, but may I submit to you that as you continue to press in and say, God, I will not go anywhere if your presence doesn't go with me. God, I'm not content to just stand in my tent door, in the place of familiarity, in my comfort zone. I want more of you. God, I'm willing to pay the price. I'm willing to do whatever is necessary so that the glory of God will saturate me in such a way that I can walk out the door and people are literally overwhelmed with the glory of God. I don't know about you, but I long for that day. And this last passage in Exodus, again, I don't want to take too much time and belabor any one thing, because we're coming to the apex of what I believe God wants to say here. But Exodus chapter 40, we will put those verses up. In verse 34 of Exodus 40, it's the last chapter in the book of Exodus. Again, we're revisiting the tabernacle, but something a little different happens this time. Apparently, the people have learned something now. Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Get this. And now Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode there, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And when the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onward in all of their journeys. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not journey until the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was upon the tabernacle by day, and fire was on it by night in the sight of the house of Israel, of all the house of Israel, throughout all their journeys. Man, if y'all aren't fired up, I am, okay? This is exciting. God says, okay, I think you guys are getting a little hungrier for the presence of God. Let me show you what really happens when I really show up. You thought that was good? It's going to get better, because I'm going to show up big time in such a way that I push out your ability to do anything. Chew on that just for a minute. Chew on that just for a second. The Bible says that the glory of God filled the tabernacle so completely that even Moses, who got the tablets of the law, the covenant, right? Who spoke with God as a man speaks with his friend, he couldn't even walk. Because the glory saturated the place. And from that point on, the symbol was, only when the cloud lifts can we move. Now, if you know anything about the desert, which is where they were in the Middle East, it's extremely hot during the day. And the only thing that is merciful to you is if there's a cloud cover. How interesting that God gave them a cloud cover by day, merciful to them in the heat of the desert. May I suggest to you, and I completely understand it because that's where I am right now, that whatever your trials are, however dry it seems, however parched you are, however difficult your circumstances, God's got a cloud cover for you. You just have to access. If you individually and I individually will continue to practice the presence of the Lord, will continue to access Him, will continue to say, I'm not taking one step unless you go with me. I want to tell you something. There's a cloud cover that comes of the glory of the Lord. I can tell you, I wouldn't have made it, especially through the last 5 years, if it weren't for that. I wouldn't have made it. But there are times where that cloud cover, I know it's there, because I'd be burnt up if it wasn't. Now, if you also know anything about the desert, at night, the temperature drops and the critters come out. They only come out at night. Some of you got that. Please, Pastor Bob laughed. And what scares them away? Exactly, the fire. So what was the fire? The fire was both to keep them warm and to push away the predators. May I submit to you that when we allow the fire of God to burn out the dross in our lives, to burn up the bad attitudes, to burn out those motives and hidden things of the heart that we don't want to admit we're grappling with, when we allow the fire of God to burn that stuff up, it pushes away the predators. Glory to God. Somebody ought to get excited about that, man. Hallelujah. See, I'm not letting you off the hook today. Have you noticed that you have a responsibility? And I know you guys know this, but I feel like God is just saying, you know, it doesn't matter where any of us are at, God wants to take us further. Leaders can't lead where they've never been. So God's pressing on all of us. I want you to do more to press into my glory, to press into my presence. Now, this is our keynote scripture, and I'm so excited about this because it was what he started singing, what Jez shared, what you all sang today, what Pastor Celine shared, and that's Habakkuk 2:14, if you put that up. You all know this. For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. A couple of key phrases I want to talk about, and then we're going to talk about what the glory is. It doesn't say the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. That's not what it says. It says the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, just as the waters cover the sea. What I love about Word of Life so much, and those of you that are, you know, coming and being part of this from time to time. Happy to see my friends Ken and Olga Shavanov here. And I know we still have some others? Evia, do we have anybody else here from CFC still? Anyone else? Okay. Are you here from CFC? Oh, wonderful. Oh, no, she's looking at it. She's going, no. I didn't think so, but that's okay. Are you Russian, darling? I did tease. But I really love the way all of you are so hungry, not just to be in God's presence, but you're hungry for the knowledge of Him. You're hungry for the tools and the keys that will help you walk this stuff out. So here's the thing. God isn't just giving that to you so you have it. He's giving that to you so you can give it to others. For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, just as the waters cover the sea. Waters and sea, such biblical symbols. What does the New Testament tell us? The washing of water of the Word, right? We need to constantly have the Word, the revelation of God's truth in the Bible. And the sea speaks of humanity, the sea of mankind, all kindreds, tribes, tongues, and nations. Yep. Amen? And God is saying, take the knowledge that I give you of my glory to the sea of humanity. Take the washing of the water of the Word that I've put in you and take it to others who don't know any better. Take it. Now, we're going to unpack this word glory. And I have to quote Brother Tommy Tenney here. Those of you who never read his book, The Glory, is it Glory Chasers? God Chasers, I always say the wrong word. Anyway, God Chasers. It's an older classic that if you haven't read it, you should read it. I have been in many Tommy Tenney meetings, and it never fails, that at one point in the meeting, the glory of God shows up and everybody either ends up on the floor or weeping. Never fails. He carries a special anointing for this. But this word glory in Habakkuk 2:14 is one of my favorite words in the Old Testament. It is the word chabad, the chabad. It means many things. It means the splendor of the Lord, the copiousness, which basically speaks of something that doesn't run out, honor. It means dignity. But the most important meaning of this word is the weight or weightiness of God. You got to get this because this is so powerful. Tommy shared about a dear friend of his, a pastor who'd had some serious health issues with his thyroid and other things to the point where he weighed well over 350 pounds. And he would try and visit members of his congregation, but it became embarrassing because he would look in their living room for the biggest couch or the most sturdy chair, but inevitably when he sat in it, it would break or become damaged. A great revelation came from this because one day, weeping, he said to Tommy Tenney, I wish somebody would have something weighty enough for me to sit on where I don't have to make a fleeting visit, but I can come and I can stay. And immediately the Lord spoke to Tommy Tenney and said, that is exactly what I want. I am looking for a people who will build such a strong and solid foundation on the inside of themselves that they can handle the weight of my glory. Because I'm not just looking to give you a fleeting visit. Are you willing to become a habitation? Are you willing to allow me to build in you into such a depth and degree that you become someone who is a habitation for me? So not long after I was in that meeting, and we all ended up in that meeting in particular, it was at the Brownsville Revival, on our faces just weeping before the Lord. I will never forget, just waves and waves and waves of God's glory came. So about a month or so later, I was in my kitchen, and I am nowhere near as efficient as she is, but sometimes the spirit of Celine McDonald can come upon me. And I was buzzing around getting all kinds of things done, and I was doing the dishes. Some of you are laughing, as you know. I was doing the dishes, and I was just really going, and all of a sudden I began to just sing these worship songs, which that wasn't necessarily unusual for me, but it was one of those times where you would have thought I was leading worship at Word of Life. I mean, it was like one incredible song after the other just began to roll out of me. I thought, man, even when I planned worship services, they weren't this good, you know? It was really one of those things that you had to credit to the Holy Spirit. And God was taking me deeper and deeper and deeper, and I felt Him kind of whisper in my ear, you need to go in the next room and just lay prostrate before the Lord. And I'm like, well, I got to finish the dishes. I like the nod. She gets it. And I'm just really, and I'm like starting to feel agitated now because God's pushing on me, like, lay down the towel. I'm like, just one more dish. Lay down the towel. Just one more dish. Lay down the towel. Just one more dish. Lay down the towel. You know, not quite, but you know, that was sort of what it felt like. Some of you are laughing because you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes we get so busy, even doing things for God. Just one more dish, God. And what we don't understand is if we will stop and listen and obey Him, we may just have one of the greatest visitations of God we've ever known. So literally, and I will attempt to demonstrate this and might need someone to help me later, but so I went into the next room and had a giant pool table in it. It was like the rec room, and I just began to go in a circle, lift my hands, just began to worship the Lord, and literally it felt as though somebody, where's John Durgan? I need you, bud. Now you have to be gentle with me in real life, because I want you to put your hands on my shoulders. Thanks for letting me borrow them. And it's as though this big guy was behind me, okay, just follow me. And as though he was pushing me, he's not really, he's being nice. And I could not, okay, what's going on here? And I kept moving like this, okay, you could go ahead and be seated, until literally I ended up like this on the floor. And for about an hour, I laid there. And I literally could not move because I felt the kabod of the weightiness of the glory of the Lord. See, I want you to get this visual because we can talk about this. Sorry for the click. Okay? We can talk about this, but I want you to see something, that the day is coming if we will really submit to the Lord, that God's going to take our excuses away. I love the way Michelle and Lisa shared about that in the dance class. God's going to take our excuses away. Oh, I got to do this, God, whatever, and say, if you'll let me, I'll come and I will really rest on you. But you won't be able to move. You won't be able to do anything in your own strength. You won't be able to do anything in your own ability. And as I lay there for an hour with an experience that I really don't have adequate words to describe, I realized something. I am not fully ready to carry the weight, the weightiness, the splendor, the honor, the dignity of the glory of the Lord the way I know you've called me to. Little did I know that not long after that, I would enter into a series of massive Job's trials. Some of you know my story and some of you don't. But I entered into a season of being literally stripped in every area of my life, going through trauma and crisis and devastation and loss. But I do know that God is building in me a habitation. I want to have such a solid foundation. I want God to get rid of bad attitudes. I want God to press hard on every motive in my heart that is not right. I want God to deal with my motivations. I want him to go into the deep and the hidden places, things I didn't even know I grappled with, and say, can I put my finger on that? And I want my immediate response to be yes. Because the earth cannot know the glory of the Lord unless you and I have walked in it and experienced it. Because it isn't just about what the words say, my friends. It's about walking it out. It's about saying, God, I'll do whatever it takes. I'll allow you to do whatever you need to do in me, as painful as it may be. Because here's what I want you to hear. Don't want to break when you come and you put your weight on me. How many times have you seen people do that? How many times have you seen people that God's put his hand on and has called and anointed and chosen them? And when the heat gets turned up and things get really difficult, they break. But I have some really good news for you. You serve the master potter, and he can take a broken and a marred vessel and put it right back on the potter's wheel. And he can mend that vessel and take even that marred vessel and make it like new. Because the master potter is really good at that. I know this is a serious message, but I really believe God wants to take us to a serious place in him. Because there is a destiny and a calling on this ministry that is really unique. I talk about this church everywhere I go. I send people here, don't I? Because you've paid a price, a dear price, and continue to pay a dear price to have what you have, to walk where you walk. But God's saying, are you ready to go deeper? Are you really ready to be my habitation where I can dwell? Not just come and visit and then I have to kind of leave because you can't quite handle that. And come and visit and, you know, then I got to leave because you can't quite, you know, that's about all you can deal with. And God's saying, I want the day to come where I just land and I don't leave. Do we really believe that can't happen? Because the word is filled with it. Even in the midst of darkness, in every generation, God always had a group he called the remnant. God always had people that wouldn't bow their knee to other gods. God always has had people. Throw them in the lion's den, they won't deny God. Throw them in the fiery furnace, no sweat. Jesus just shows up and rescues them because they won't bow. They won't deny God. Try to boil them with oil. Hint, hint, the Apostle John. Can't do it. Can't kill him. Not his time to go. He had to have the revelation of the Christ at the end times. It wasn't his time yet. God always has people that say, I'm in all the way. Whatever it takes. I have a quote here from my precious late father, Pastor Mel Cuno. I really want you to hear this because it's powerful. Are we clicking? I'm sorry. What do I need to move? We good? Okay. God is going to spring his leaders out of bondage and restriction and free them to preach the gospel unfettered. I'm going to say that again. God is going to spring his leaders out of bondage and restriction and free them to preach the gospel unfettered. Some of you instantly tune me out. You know why? Because I use the word leaders. Oh, yeah, I'm going to nail you hard. You know I am. Because you're all leaders. Everybody in this room is a leader. If you're a parent, you're leading your children. If you brought a friend to church, you're leading your friend. Trust me, all of you in this room are leaders way more than you think you are. So no defaulting. So I'm going to say this one more time. God is going to spring his leaders out of bondage and restriction and free them to preach the gospel unfettered. Look at the world that we live in. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? Violence covers the earth. We could go on and on and on with the scriptures and pinpoint where we're at right now. Right? In the middle of it, God wants to free his leaders out of bondage and restriction so they can preach the gospel. What does it mean unfettered? No chains. Nothing holding you back. Nothing. And what is the key to that? The key is truly the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, the weightiness, the chabad of who he is. See, when you really get a revelation of that, you realize you can't, you know, you can't play church. Not that I think anyone here does, but you can't not be serious about God because suddenly you realize what you're dealing with. You know, even if you were to appear before Queen Elizabeth in England, you cannot walk with your back to her out of the room. You have to back out of the room. Here in Western culture, we have such a hard time fathoming the majesty of our king and the awesomeness of his splendor because we don't have that kind of culture. But I believe it is one of the things, and I shared this with our wonderful Kathy, because God is going to display his majesty. He's going to reveal himself as King of kings and Lord of lords. Tsay tsayre bog magov slavi tibia. King of kings, Lord of lords, I worship you in Russian. See, he is going to reveal his majesty. And I will tell you what, we won't be able to do anything but give him honor and glory. Another quote in that same teaching that my father gave, Pastor Mel Kuno, there has got to be an urgency in God to get the gospel message out. He's got to put wings on it. Now, here's what I want to say. This all ties together. We're going to lead to our last scripture because we're probably going to skip one of them. This isn't just about you and I experiencing God's glory. This isn't just about God tickling our fancy. This isn't just about God giving us goosebumps and ooh, isn't that cool? That's all great. And he loves to do that. But this is about us becoming saturated with the glory of God and getting the heart of God to have a sense of urgency to go out there and get wings placed on us by the Holy Ghost to get out and get the gospel message to the ends of the earth. Now, the ends of the earth for you might be your next door neighbor. Might be one of your family members. It might be someone you work for or work with. It might be someone that you're part of a committee, an outreach committee. Committee, yeah, I made up a new word. Really got rolling on that one. It might be anyone that God calls you to nearby. It might be like Don Wilk that God sends you way far away to Madagascar. And we're not talking the cartoon. You don't know where he's going to send you, but I do know this. God wants to place a sense of urgency in each and every one of us. We have got to get the gospel message to others. The earth needs to have the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. So first you learn about it, then you experience it, and then you make yourself a habitation for the glory of God. And then, trust me, you'll have wings. You'll get out there and you'll be able to share the gospel message with anyone God sends you to. Last but not least, I only want to say this. You want to put up the reference on 1 Peter 5. The books of 1 and 2 Peter are actually written to the suffering church. Again, a concept we have a bit of a hard time with in the Western culture. I hope we don't lose what we have. It's hard to say where we're going in this nation. But I will tell you this, I have lived in other countries where there is not that freedom. And there's something about a suffering church that they've got one of two choices. They either rise up and are strong and defy all the odds and share the gospel, or they say, forget it, and I give up. You're not going to like what I'm about to say. The persecuted church is the strongest church. Because it takes more to serve God when you're being persecuted for your faith than it does when you're not. But there's a direct correlation in the books of 1 and 2 Peter between suffering and the glory of God. Over and over again, you see both mentioned, suffering and the glory of God, suffering and the glory of God. And what does Romans 8 tell us? I didn't put this in the notes, but I always say God must have been Southern when he wrote this, for I reckon, y'all, that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Hallelujah. And then the last verse, we're going to end with this. 2 Corinthians 3:18. Really love this verse. I know you're familiar with it. But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Aren't you glad that it's not our job to be changed into the image of the glory of God? That he does, the Holy Spirit does the work. Our job is to yield. Our job is to say, yes, sir. Our job is to say, okay, I'm going to lay this down that you've asked me to lay down. Or I'm going to submit this to you that you've asked me to submit. Or I'm going to fill in the blank. But the good news is he's the one that does the work. And I love this word doxa. It's D-O-X-A, which is the Greek word for glory for 2 Corinthians 3:18. I'm going to end with this concept. And if the worship team would begin to slowly make their way up, please. We're going to worship in just a moment and sing about the glory of God again. But this word doxa means many things. It means dignity, glory, honor, like we discussed before. But in really digging it out, what I loved in looking at all the root words is it means an outward manifestation of an inward state of being. I'll say that again. An outward manifestation of an inward state of being, or literally to show or manifest the glory of God. See, God wants to bring us to that place where we say, okay, God, whatever it takes, whatever you've got to do in my life, whatever path or road that I need to traverse, I'm willing, God. I'm willing for you to do the work that you want to do in my life. I'm willing for you, God, to just, thank you, to take me and work such a deep work on the inside of me that I'm not just, are you hearing, isn't it funny what we use the expression that I'm not just a lightweight? Right? Don't we use that term? What do we mean by a lightweight? Someone that can't handle it when things get heavy. Amen? Amen. I like you because you're hungry for God, young man. God doesn't want us to be lightweights. He wants us to be an habitation for his glory. He wants us to be those that will say, okay, God, bring it. Bring the kabod. I may end up flat on my face. I may not be able to move. I may not be able to do any of the things I thought I was going to do. I may be like Moses on the backside of the desert, stuttering, going, who, me? You want to use me? But God wants to bring us to that place where we totally surrender and yield ourselves to him, humble ourselves before him, and say, whatever it takes, I want to be a habitation for the glory of the Lord.